Hello everybody, my name is CulBlu, and I bring you guys this video in the Small Box Big Game series. I guess it's the official name for it. I'm stuck with it. I gotta deal with it one way or another. But this is gonna be finally going over the Tiny Epic family of games. As you guys can see here, I have all the Tiny Epic games on the side all lined up. And for anybody who doesn't know what the Tiny Epic game series is all about, it's all about having a nice experience in a small box, so a nice meaningful gamey feeling experience inside of a small box, or at least that's what it feels like that they're attempting to do. And I say they, it's really Scott Elms, he's the one who's designing most of them, but he also has, you know, people who are helping him and testing and doing the artwork and all this other stuff. But I don't have all the special details on that. But as far as these games, the main goal is that it's an experience in a small box. And just for reference, for anybody out there who may not be familiar with how big the size is of the Tiny Epic games, I was bringing out a few common games that people might actually have lying around the house. Carcassonne, Seven Wonders, and Small World are relatively common games. So these are the box size for these games. And as you can see, Tiny Epic, I can basically fit almost the entire series on Seven Wonders. So these are relatively small boxes. And I keep saying relatively small boxes because a small box to me is even smaller than this, but still these are considered the small box games. But they have a lot of games out of them, so it's just some stuff for reference, just to give you guys a nice little visual. Alright, so we're going to go and just reset this up, and we'll start talking about the games. Okay, so here we are, we're set back up to talk about the Tiny Epic series. Like I said, I'm gonna try to talk about each one in a little bit of detail. I'm gonna show you guys a little bit of what the board looks like. I'm just gonna zoom in and just show you some piece and talk about some of the mechanics. And really, this is gonna be more or less of a pros and cons of me of each game. And I'll tell you guys my favorites and then my least favorite things. And at the end, I'll go ahead and summarize by telling you guys which ones I like the most versus which ones I'm not the biggest fan of the series. So all in all, I am very, very, very a huge fan of the Tiny Epic series. If you haven't already, you know, picked up on that, the fact that I own all these and also I'm making a video about it and also keep saying how awesome these games are. The Tiny Epic series, in my opinion, is a really, really nice, ambitious project that I think needed to happen because you have a lot of big box experiences. Like you have your Carcassonne, you have your Seven Wonders, you have your Small Worlds. So you have a lot of your common big box experiences, even bigger than that if you want to go to something like Forbidden Stars or Imperial Assault or Zombicide. But nobody really focuses enough on like the quality smaller box games, which I'm a fan of because I can carry more of those with me. So I have a lot of bias when it comes to games that are smaller. Like the smaller the game and the better the experience, the better for me overall. And the Tiny Epic series, they've been relatively consistent with providing a nice experience. So enough of me yammering, let me go ahead and just introduce each game, and we'll go ahead and talk about them in the order. Or sorry, we'll go ahead and look at them in the order that they came out. So these are the four games here. This is Tiny Epic Kingdoms. Tiny Epic Kingdoms is a 4X. It's a 4X game where you're trying to expand, explore, exploit, and exterminate. Tiny Epic Galaxies is a 3X. I like to call it a 3X game. Same thing, you're trying to expand, explore, and exploit. You're not really exterminating in this one, so this one kind of does a good job of, I guess, keeping it competitive. Tiny Epic Defenders is a co-op game where you're trying to defend an area and trying to make sure you don't lose. And Tiny Epic Western is a nice grab bag of a few different mechanics, but mostly it's a set collection game. So that's a very generic, rough summary of every game. Let's go ahead and start talking about the first one in the series, which is Tiny Epic Kingdoms. So here I have a setup of Tiny Epic Kingdoms, and this is just a rough setup. This is a three-player game setup. There's a lot of stuff all over the place. I do want to go ahead and preface this by saying that this is not going to be a definitive tutorial on how to play this game. This is more so going to be me showing you guys a setup, just giving you a good feel for how the game actually looks, and then I'll talk about some of the mechanics as the games go along. I'm going to try to keep that consistent between all the games in the Tiny Epic series because you could spend quite a while explaining all the rules. And I'm going to try to avoid that if possible. So I'm just going to zoom in here on the section that I'm only going to concern myself about. So in Tiny Epic Kingdoms, you're basically exploring, you're trying to exploit the land. So these are the lands that we'll be exploring. And there's usually one per person that's playing the game. So as you can see, there's three here, but one's off screen. And these are two of the characters that are in the game, or two of the players that are in the game. So there's a lot of different races in this game, which is what I like. It gives a lot of variety. And each different clan or each different class or race or whatever you want to call it has their own special abilities. So let's go ahead and bring in these cards here that are not in actually check it. There we go. Cool. So we're focused in. So as you can see, the Dark Elves, they have a few different abilities. Like at level 1 on the magic track, they cannot be attacked if there's only 2 meeples in play, and so on and so forth. And then you have the orcs, who do other things. They do other nasty things to people. And then you have the elves, who are really good with magic. The undead, who really just want, or who really just get a bunch of free people. And you have a lot of different variety, and everybody feels different. That's one of the things I like about the game too. So every class feels different as you play along, and it actually feels like you're playing something. So if I had to compare this to a game, I would say this kind of has a small world type feel to it. I mean, you're not really moving a stack of cardboard and trying to take over things, of course, but it kind of has that feel with the whole uniqueness of the different classes that you can have, that you can play as. And I guess small world is a bad comparison, but overall, I feel like it has that same push and pull where you're trying to get more resources and get more land, because this game is also about exploring the resources. So as you can see, everybody, with the exception of me for some reason, has their resource track over here. And you'll be collecting resources as you go along the game. And of course you have the 3 different types of resources, which are food, magic, and ore. magic and ore can be used for fighting, or magic can be used to research your magic level to give you more special abilities for your class over here. Or you can use food can be used for expanding, so adding more people into your area so they can have more control. And of course food or ore is used to do the building track. And the building track is over here. It's just another way to get victory points. So it's a lot of different things, and one of the most interesting mechanics is that this also has if you guys have ever played something like San Juan or Puerto Rico, where basically somebody is the start player, so somebody's the head player. So say the centaurs down here are the start player. That person will get to choose the action to do. Now, this action card is basically where the whole game kind of revolves around. This action card, there's 6 different actions that can be had. There's 5 little shield tokens here. Essentially, the person who's active will choose any of the ones that are not filled. So let's say the centaurs wanted to do a quest. Quest is essentially moving from one card to another. Then the centaurs, they have to choose to do the quest. So the blue person is going to choose the quest. So he moves one of the meeples here. Let's say he moves it over here to that place, because why not? Then they have successful quest. Then everybody else around and going in clockwise order would get an opportunity to either quest or collect resources. Now keep in mind that the person who chose the action, they have to do the action, but everybody else gets the option of either, do I want to collect resources for I am, or do I want to go ahead and do the action, or is that beneficial to me? And that's kind of where it has that role selection deal, because I mean, somebody is selecting the role or the action selection, and everybody else gets to do it or do something else. So it's a nice little touch into the game. There's a fighting mechanic too. I'm not the biggest fan of it. I think it's kind of weird. I mean, I guess you got to manage your resources, but the fighting system is essentially 2 people choose resources to allocate. Whoever has a higher number wins, defender's advantage. Basically the entire thing. It's not the most exciting thing in the world, but you can exterminate people in this game, and it has happened to me, and I actually don't appreciate that aspect of the game, but it is a part of the game. I don't appreciate that aspect of the game in the sense that, you know, this game is not the quickest in the world. It says about 45 minute game, and my experience has always been about an hour 15 or hour and 30 minutes. So it depends if you have people like me or somebody else who sits and thinks about the turn over and over and over, or try to combos or moves. But a lot of times your choices are very straightforward. But even then, player elimination does hurt a lot, because you get eliminated and you're just kind of sitting there like, ah, darn, messed up on that part. Should have expanded more, should have explored more. So, I mean, there's a few different pros and cons to the game, but for the most part, I like it. It gives me that nice feel of, like, I am playing a Civ building game. I am building up my characters. I'm trying to win. I'm getting the points. I am powerful because I have these special abilities, and I'm chaining them together. I'm doing cool things. So it has a lot of redeeming qualities about it. So that is basically all I'll say about Tiny Epic Kingdoms. I can go on and on, but it'll pretty much be the same information. Let's go ahead and see if we can jump into the next game, which is Tiny Epic Defenders. Tiny Epic Defenders is a game where you're basically trying to defend the central city. So as you can see, this is a 3-player game I set up. It might be a little bit difficult to see until I zoom in, but there's 1 player over here, 1 player over there, 1 player over there. So you set up the board and you're trying to defend, and there's things attacking and you're trying to do stuff, and you get artifacts if you do certain things, which is awesome. They give you special abilities. There's a lot to be talked about in this game, and I'm gonna go ahead and just preface by saying I'm not gonna explain every rule, but I'm just gonna kind of talk about on the pros and cons of the game overall, so you guys can just get a good feel for it. If you want to see a playthrough, go watch other people play through it, because there's a few playthroughs of this. They're actually pretty good. So what I'm going to do, this is the typical setup. Basically, this is connected to that, and then you have to get to here to walk to those places. So you can't just walk directly to it. So it's like a certain pattern. But I'm going to break this pattern so I can bring in the character cards and zoom in a little bit so we can actually read what's on the cards. Might be a slight bit difficult to read, but no worries. I'll try to read out the important things that are here. But as far as the game goes, the game attempts to have like a pandemic type feel, or tries to give that good co-op where you have to work together with your colleagues, you have to work together with your fellow heroes to actually win the game, and the world's in peril and you're just getting hit by monster upon monster upon monster. And it does a good job of making you feel like you're overwhelmed, but it doesn't do a good job of making you feel like you have control of a situation. Now, that's really, really, really touchy. This game puts a lot of people on edge when you talk about the Tiny Epic series. It's mainly because you don't control when you get to defend or when things happen. So, I'll explain a little bit more of that, because that's pretty much going to be like the primary qualm with this game for just about everybody. Just to explain the game a little bit more, these characters here, they can move in certain areas, and you spend your life points to actually move in places. So as you can see here, the cleric, he has a special ability, which he can do cool things, because everybody starts with two actions once they activate. And he has a special ability, he can, you know, spend an action to do a heal, and he can do all cool things and move. So he can spend an action to move to the next place, and he can spend another action to move to another place, and now he's out of actions. And you can choose to, if you want, you can spend your life to push yourself one more, to move one more, so you lose life. And if you ever reach zero life, you don't die. You don't die in this game, which is cool. You just can't do anything until you get back to the city and heal. Like, you literally cannot activate anything. You cannot do anything special. And that kind of sucks, because you have to resort. You have to manage your resources for your hero. So you have to occasionally visit the capital city to heal. So that's one kind of limiting factor in the game, which makes sense because this is a small game. There's not a ton of pieces in this game, which I appreciate that too. Whereas Tiny Epic Kingdom is like 1,000 pieces in that thing, I swear. But it makes sense to kind of limit your resources like that. So that's one thing that's, you know, I think it's a plus. Some people don't like that mechanic. I think it's cool to have to manage your life resource to allow you to move, because you have to plan. Moving into the next part, each different location has a special ability. So the capital city here, for example, if you're in a capital city, you can replenish your health. You can replenish all your health if you start your turn there, which is awesome. So that means if you start your turn there, you can go and heal and then go do stuff. The plane says patrol. Patrol costs 0 action points to move out of the planes. So that means that if you'll spend 1 action point to move here, and then for free, you can just jump to another spot. So that's awesome. The mountains, they do a thing. The forest, it does a thing too. So each location does a different thing, and there's two sides to each card. So that kind of adds to the replayability. So the other side of the planes, for example, safeguard. You may defend the two adjacent outer regions as if you were in them, which is useful. All right, so just to go ahead and talk a little bit more about the frustration too. It's like, I mean, you have to manage where you're at, and you have to be in the right place at the right time. You have to utilize your resources, and yeah, I guess this game does do a good job of giving that feel of like, oh no, the world is falling down. And just to continue the examples to before, I have in here shuffled the character cards who are active, and I have all the monsters in here. Now, as you go along, as you defeat, or as areas get defeated, like as an area gets destroyed, then that card goes out of the deck, which is useful to know, because you know that that card is no longer in the deck, because this is destroyed, cool. But, yeah, it still doesn't help it not be all that frustrating. So, let's say for instance that green has no health, and blue is down to 1 health. And red is stuck in the city, so red needs to get out of there. So red really needs to move to an area that's more useful. Keep in mind, there's supposed to be 2 more locations in this area down here. So first thing that happens is that shows up. So 2 places get attacked, which would be the mountains, which is here. And it will be also the city, which would be down here in this area. So now, what can happen is that green's in a place that they may defend the outer region as if they were in the same spot. So that means green can take a hit. Actually, no, green can't take a hit because green has no health, right? I'm gonna add. Sorry, green has 0 health, so green cannot take a hit. So that means that this region will automatically take a hit, and also the city would take a hit. So then we go to the next card. This card shows up and says drain. Players choose 1 hero to immediately lose 2 health points. So that shows up. All right, that's a pretty nasty guy. And you would not have all of these guys in there at the same time. You would have only a few. So actually, let me Let me make this a little bit less frustrating for the viewers at home. I think you only have two of them in. So you only have two of those super nasty, we're gonna make this game super hard, guys. And so that guy shows up, he does things, and if you defeat him, you get an artifact, so you get a benefit. So let's say somebody defeats him. Yay, we defeated him. Woo, we got an artifact. Artifact allows me to get free action. For free action, you can cause 2 points of damage to an epic foe, regardless of location. Oh, that's pretty nice. Right? So epic foe is the main boss that you fight. So next card shows up, two places get attacked, and remember, red still really needs to like go and do stuff, because red is actually useful right now, but green is stuck in the bad spot. So this happens, oh no, the forest shows up. So now the forest, which was here, over here, which is defeated, don't forget, means that the city takes a hit. So that means that technically the red can defend. So red will defend with one life, make sure that doesn't die. It says cost 3 health points to defend against this. Oh wait, sorry, red only has 1 health, my bad. Nope, that's not getting defended. So this is gonna take 1 hit instead of just 3. And the Minotaur, he's good, he's gonna chill. The enemy, well, let's see, forest gets hit again. Red's gonna take that hit, so red's now at 0 health, and the city's defended. And then the mountains, they're gonna get hit too, and so are the plains, which green cannot defend because he has no health. And as you can see, like, I've gone through the deck so far, and this was just a random shuffle. Finally, green can go, so green can get out of there and get back into the city. So green can't do anything else but sit there and heal until next time around, which is the next shuffle of the deck. And then, now blue can go. Cool. All right, so blue's gonna go ahead and, let's see. It takes 2 actions to leave this desert. So that's the special ability of the desert. So green has to spend 2 of his actions to move out. So 1, 2. And I actually think you get 4 actions. I'm not sure. I need to look back up on that. But anyway, let's assume you get 4 actions. I feel like I misquoted that rule, because 2 is not enough. You get 4 actions. So that's 1, 2. And then 3, and then 4 is to move over here to Plains, because Plains is efficient at defending both of those. Next card comes out. Oh, finally red can do something. So now red's going to be super useful by, I don't know, healing back up to max because it started in the city. Then moving over here, it's going to help reduce this, reduce that. So that's 1, 2. Oh, you can move out of this. No, that's not this one. So 1, 2, 3, and then 4 is to move over here. And then next thing happens, something gets attacked. Yeah, cool. All right, then we shuffle the deck here. And then we just keep going, and we keep going, and we keep going. So the fact that you can't control when you go or who goes or when they go is really, really frustrating with this game. Literally, it's just that mechanic that's keeping this from being one of my enjoyable games, because I actually like co-op games, especially small box co-op games, like One Deck Dungeon. I did a walkthrough of that because I actually like that game. That's a co-op, technically. You can play a 2-player. I wouldn't because I'm so selfish, but it works okay, too. So that's really it to really talk about Tiny Epic Defenders. This one went a little bit longer because I wanted to explain in a little bit more detail as to why this one's usually thought of as the most unpopular one in the series. And also just let everybody know that it's not actually a bad game. It's just, it has that one mechanic that's really frustrating. If you could choose when you got to go, then I can see this game being enjoyable. I actually might house rule it and see if it works. Just do a house rule where like you can, any person can choose to go after 2 monsters have attacked or something, which would, you know, you have to play with the balance of that, but we'll see. Anyway, so that's it for Tiny Epic Defenders. Let's go and jump into the next one, which is Tiny Epic Galaxies. All right, so Tiny Epic Galaxies here. This is the very condensed, rough setup of the game. Basically, there's 3 different players playing right now. These are the areas. This is the play area that we're fighting over right now, and this is the activation dice bay, and this is a dice, and there's extra planets, blah. So, like I said, not going to be a definitive talkthrough, not going to be a definitive playthrough. Just reminding you guys once again. I'm gonna glaze over a lot of rules, but for the most part, this game is, it was one of my favorite games. There's another one in the series that just knocked it off recently, which obviously is the last one that I'm going to talk about. But all that said and done, Tiny Epic Galaxies, I like it as a game because it has a very fascinating mechanic of making people pay attention. So as you guys can see, there's a lot of information here. The main thing is that these are the planets that we are fighting over, and these over here are planetary or galaxies, those are the player cards. And you'll be upgrading your civilization as you go along. You'll be managing your resources, so you'll be trying to exploit your resources here on this little track over here. Got your planets, got your upgrade track over there. You're going to have some extra special abilities from planets as you conquer more planets. You'll have more abilities to use down here, and they'll tuck under your card just like so. So there's a lot of many different little combinations you can have. Of all the games in the Tiny Epic series, I think this one is definitely second. I say recently because of Tiny Epic Western, this one's only second in games that are most prone to AP or analysis paralysis, where you're just kind of sitting there trying to analyze everything and trying to see if you can chain this and chain that and get this because of that and get that because of this. Really, really annoying for some people, but I actually appreciate that thing in the games because, you know, it gives me a little bit more time to think, and also I'm usually the one doing it. So there's that. So I don't know how well you guys will see it on the setup, but there's actually ships on the planet standing up. You do use these ships in standing up form and then laying down form. So if they're laying down and they're trying to orbit around the planet, that means that you're trying to conquer the planet. And you're trying to reach that area so you can conquer the planet. Then you'll claim it as victory points, which are listed down here. And then you'll get the ability as a colony ability that you can use whenever you roll that face on the dice. You also have the ability to just fly and land on top of the planet. If you land on the planet, then you can use that ability immediately, which is awesome. So as you go along, you'll be doing a combination of, you know, trying to use this ability to give you that, and then maybe use your own colony's ability that you have acquired over time to try to chain other moves and become an efficient thing. You're trying to build sort of an engine. I mean, it's just definitely an engine builder. I mean, it's an engine builder. Also, it's dice rolling too. Forgot to talk about the dice. There's dice that you roll, and this is where the mechanic that I like the most comes in, because, you know, in some games, somebody takes a turn, they do a thing, and then you might be on your phone for a little bit, or you might be having a conversation, might just go grab some food. This game kind of discourages that, because if you have enough of a certain resource, you can actually follow or copy somebody's dice. So let's say somebody did a roll, and they did something I really wanted to do. Like, let's say somebody used a move action that I really wanted to use. So let's say yellow decided to use a move action to move this ship from over there to over there. And I say, you know what, I'm CulBlu. I got enough resources to follow this, so I'm gonna choose to follow. So the follow action is basically to copy the dice face of somebody who's active. So you're not the active player, but if you have the resource, you can say, I'm following that action. And then I now get to take one of my ships that are available and move it somewhere, so I can put it over there. And it's really, really, you know, it's a cool mechanic because it's a nice way to force people to pay attention to the game. I've had a lot of situations at game nights, especially since I play party games as well, so I like party games. I also like games that are super serious. I've had a lot of situations where, you know, we're playing a game and then somebody's either not paying attention, or maybe I'm not paying attention, because that happens every once in a while. And then the turn comes back around, everybody's just waiting on you, and you didn't get to spend a moment to think about what you're going to do, and then AP kicks in, and then everybody's sad. So this game does a good job of preventing that, because you have to pay attention to your opponent's turn. Because there are a lot of times where the lead is gotten not because you have conquered those planets or your strategy was superior, but mainly because you paid attention and you had that key follow. Like, if somebody says, I'm gonna upgrade my colony, you can say, all right, it's not my turn to do things, but I'm gonna upgrade my colony as well. And you choose to spend your resources, so you follow that action, you upgrade your colony. So that way next time around, your turn is super efficient and you can do whatever the heck you want. So I really, really, really do praise this game for literally just that mechanic. Everything else in this game is fantastic as well. It claims to be a 4X game. There's no real extermination. I mean, there are some take that abilities coming out from some of these cards, and there are a ton of planets, by the way. This is a whole deck of planets. So there's a ton of different variety that you can have with the game, different resource counts, different abilities, different effects. Some take energy away from people, some give it to people, some take things, resources from people, and then you have your bonus points that you can earn at the end of the game, so some secret scoring in the game too. This game has a lot to love. It's recently fallen down to second place for me, mainly because Tiny Epic Western is so epic and Western-like. So we're actually going to jump into that one next. I don't think there's really much else for me to talk about on this one. If you guys are interested in this, I would, if you're interested in Tiny Epic series and you want just a game that can kind of fill in just about all the gaps as far as, you know, replayability, having that player engagement, giving you something to think about, giving you meaningful decisions, this game is definitely one of them. I would actually probably recommend this one first over Tiny Epic Western. And then if you like this one, then get Tiny Epic Western. All right. So I think that's about it. I think I blabbed on long enough. Let's go ahead and jump on to the next one for Tiny Epic Western. All right, so we're gonna jump into Tiny Epic Western. I've kind of paused in the middle of setup because I just realized I'm not gonna be able to keep most of the game set up and then show a zoom in. So we're gonna just talk a moment just about some of the things that I like about just the board in general before I start talking about some of the mechanics that I like too. As far as this game goes, another resource management game, not really a 4X, more just like a, it's a set collection game. It's a worker placement set collection type game. This is the board that you set up, and I just want to take a moment just to appreciate the nice symmetry and just a nice idea behind the setup. So it's a very, very, very nice setup. Let me adjust my light so I don't lose everything. Okay, I'll adjust that back later. But as you can see the board has a lot of, it takes a lot of space. It also has a lot of function too. In between these areas, you have a lot of information. You have your cards. There's a poker element to this game. Then you also have your cards that are owned by people here on these sides. And this is a three-player game, so this one's flipped over. This would normally be for the blue player. But I sadly had to take the blue player out because I didn't have enough space to put the cards over there. And each area has its own thing that you're trying to fight for resources. So this is how you collect your resources here and also here. And then you're also trying to compete for the trademark or stock market up here, and you're also trying to win the poker hand. You're also trying to buy the better building down there. It's a lot of things going on in this game, and the board does a really good job. I mean, much better than I expected it to just kind of display all that information before you and present it in a meaningful and also stylish way. I say meaningful way. Take it with a grain of salt, because sometimes you have to read all these cards and it kind of sucks having to read these upside down and sideways. So that is a con to the game, but everything else is in a very relatively meaningful manner. So the cards, you know that this, if you're competing for this area, you're gonna have this card and your poker hands is like the river or whatever they call it. I don't play poker, so I wouldn't know, or Texas Hold'em. But these are the revealed cards, the public cards, and then you have your own card, which is a secret card, and whoever has the better suit wins. And even though it's a competitive game, sometimes you might be in an area by yourself. One nice mechanic about this game too is that you're always trying to win the poker hand. So you always have to worry about this poker hand. The reason why is because even if you're the only person here, then you'll be automatically the winner. You're still competing against the house, and the house will have its own card, which is revealed at the end. And that's also cool. And also you have some battle mechanics between the players. So many mechanics I just like about this game. Also, this did a good job of making me not like Harbor anymore. So if anybody doesn't know, if you watch the original video in the small, or the first video in the Small Box Big Game series, basically talks about how Tiny Epic Western overtook Harbor as one of my, or a game that I would actually prefer to play, because Tiny Epic Western is a more complicated version of Harbor. Turns out, same person designed both games, and I'm not surprised to see that he kind of just took that element of Harbor and just threw it in this game. There's the whole stock market deal going on here. There's the whole choose your location and do some set collection stuff. It's a lot of nice fun elements going on. So, like I said, just want to spend half the time at least appreciating the board, and then I'll try to break it down so you can see some useful information, and I'll just kind of key in on some of my other favorite mechanics. So I'll be right back. So we're finally down to the last game, Tiny Epic Western. This is the detailed part of some of the other mechanics I like, besides how awesome the board looks when you set it up. I could talk about that all day, but as far as the game goes, you're trying to collect resources again. It's like an interesting blend between Tiny Epic Galaxies over there and Tiny Epic Kingdoms over there, where like you have your worker placement that you get from Tiny Epic Kingdoms. You also have your fighting mechanics you get from Tiny Epic Kingdoms, kind of. And also you have your Tiny Epic Galaxies where you're trying to chain the abilities together and then do a lot of things. So this game really feels like a culmination of all those games were test samples to see how to build this one. I don't really know what triggered the idea for this one. This is, I'm glad it exists, I'll say that much. Mechanics that I do like about this game, now that we got the zoom in here, are the fact that each area gives you different resources, and you have to still compete for these. So for instance, if green wanted to go ahead and claim one's resources, they could either choose to claim one resource on this side, which I'll bring here front and center. We are zoomed in. No, we're not. Okay, we're zoomed in more. They can choose to claim either this resource here to this side, which gives them something immediately, like an immediate benefit, or they can choose to go for that one, which means that they have to gamble for that one, meaning that they have to win the poker hand. So your focus can always be either to say, hey, I want immediate benefits now of the one, or I want to go for the gambling benefit of the two. And if you win the immediate benefit, then, get to do more stuff on your turn. But if you go for the gamble, you might lose it. And then especially if you continue to get like some of the good resources, maybe someone will target you. So let's say green has a lot of, or green keeps winning this area over here. Maybe red's like, hey green, I don't want you winning that. So red comes over here and challenges them. And then when red challenges them, then green and red go off on a face-off, so they both roll their bullet dice, which I think is kind of cool. And they have their numbers, and then you can spend resources to re-roll dice. You can also play your poker card from your hand as a one-time booster to see if you can, you know, outgun the other person. And the winner of the duel, let's say red won, the winner of the duel will now be in consideration for winning the top pot. But even though green lost the fight, even though green lost that battle down there, green is still in, or still contesting the main pot here, or the passive pot of the area. So like you have a lot of different mechanics going on because you want to have a good poker hand, but you also need to have your resources to actually buy the buildings, because at the end of the day, these buildings will help you win the game. You can have the best poker hand in the world, but if you don't have the buildings, you're just not going to win, because it's all about getting these points up here. In this area, it's also about having the most, actually, yeah, this is literally where your points come from at the end of the game. So basically, this is another interesting mechanic too that I like a lot, kind of like the whole stock market deal. Whereas as it goes along, the winner of the house, so basically whoever wins this hand here, and that's all the players competing against each other, whoever wins this hand between this one, this three, and then their card, whoever has the winning hand will be the one that gets to move either this one, or this one up. And in each spot, essentially, only one can be in each place. So that means that if you move the orange up a lot, then you want a lot of orange symbols. And those symbols will come from the buildings that I showed you earlier, which we'll zoom in on here. Just get a good quick peek at some of the symbols. This is where the set collection comes into the game. So you have your buildings that have these symbols. So this one has orange, this one has a purple, this one has orange, this one has an orange. So you want to collect the correct symbols so you can win, but you also got to pay attention to the ability. Like the barbershop may not be the best building for you, because the barbershop lets you rearrange the building cards in the porch slot at any location mat to place another building card from the top to become unusable. I mean, that might not be useful, but the mining co might be useful for you, which gives you two orange, and it says gain one wild for every orange you own, max of three. So I mean, if you're collecting a lot of orange, you really want that building. And then people are paying attention to that, so you have to collect the resources to pay for it, and you have to have enough resources to pay for this, and then you gotta have enough resources to actually fight people, then you gotta have enough people to actually be able to claim resources, then you gotta play your poker hand, and it's like so many decisions. This game is like decision overload the game. I am enamored by this game a lot. Every time I play it, I think I almost always try the same strategy of get as much wild as I can, because that helps me be flexible. But all that said and done, there's so many choices in this game to where it's not always a good choice to get resources. Maybe it's better to just augment your card value, because there is a floor area that lets you change your poker value by either one, plus one or minus one, or you get to change the suit by plus one or minus one, so you can have a better poker hand. So I mean, there's just so many choices in this game. I can go on all day long, but I did promise I'll try to keep it somewhat limited, because I don't want this video to last forever. So I will stop talking about Tiny Epic Western. I do like this game the best out of all the series. Let's go ahead and clean this up so I can do the final talk through of all of them, and then we'll close the video out. All right, so let's go ahead and complete this video series for the Tiny Epic game series, or let's go ahead and complete this video for the Tiny Epic family of games. Everything is here except for Tiny Epic Quest. That game is still in development, so I'm not counting it for this video. I might do an update later on so I can talk about that one more. But I basically give you guys as much as I could within a reasonable amount of time, because like I said, I could literally talk about all these games for like 20 minutes per game, which I can definitely do. But of all the games though, Tiny Epic Western, definitely my favorite. Second favorite, Tiny Epic Galaxies. Tiny Epic Kingdoms is my third favorite, and Tiny Epic Defenders. I agree with the sentiment of many people that is probably the worst in the series, so it's definitely at the bottom for me. But when it comes down to all the games though, I love, like, if you look at the games in the order that I have them, it's really based on how much choice you have. There's a ton of choice in Tiny Epic Western, so I'm enamored by the game essentially. Tiny Epic Galaxies, there's choice in this game too, because you can chain this card with that, and you can do this with that, you can also copy somebody else's ability and do this. Tiny Epic Kingdoms, there's choice, but I mean, you're kind of like, it's civilization-based choice. It's like, I'm gonna upgrade my civilization and then kill people and then collect resources. I mean, it's some choice. And Tiny Epic Defenders is probably the least amount of choice in this game. So obviously I like having choice in my game. I like having decisions. I like having significant decisions. And Tiny Epic Westerns, definitely has a lot of significant, or sorry, meaningful decisions in the games, and that one definitely at the top of my charts. Of all the games though, if you're looking for the first one to jump into the series, it really depends on what you want. If you want a co-op, your obvious only choice is really Tiny Epic Defenders. If you want something that you can, you know, have a feeling that you're making a lot of significant decisions, Tiny Epic Western, I would recommend that one. If you want something that's a little bit more interactive with other players, Tiny Epic Galaxies is good. Tiny Epic Westerns, I think, is more interactive than Tiny Epic Galaxies even, but Tiny Epic Galaxies does have the nice mechanic of follow. So it's a relatively straightforward mechanic that you can use. If you want something that's is kingdom building, then Tiny Epic Kingdoms is probably the best 4X type game you can have for whatever, or for this small size of a game. So I don't really have much else to say outside of thank you guys very much for watching. You guys are all awesome, and I will see you guys whenever.